Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. It's Thursday, and that means open forum. If you got a question about the Catholic faith, you're welcome to call. Or first hour, we got Jimmy here with us, so you can ask anything you want. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. And by the way, anyone can call as well. If you are within the sound of our voices, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. Jimmy is senior apologist here at Catholic Answers, the author of a whole bunch of things, including the Bible as a Catholic book and, True Happiness and Where to Find It.
Words of Eternal Life.
Words of Eternal Life, True Happiness and Where to Find It. But perhaps most importantly, he is about to be the man debating Bart Ehrman. We'll talk a little bit more about that as the show comes up. Hi, Jimmy.
Hi, Kat. Sorry.
I'm sorry that I'm glad you did that, because I'm sorry the title of your book went right out of my head when I had the subtitle, but not the title.
That's okay. The titles of my own books go out of my head.
Do they really? That actually surprised me.
No, I'm just being kind.
Darn it! Why did I have to go that extra step? Got it. Oh, man. Well, thanks for being kind.
Not the major ones, anyway.
888-318-7884. Of course, Jimmy's also the proprietor of Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World, which is a good thing because it's called Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. What's dropping tomorrow, Jimmy?
We're taking patron questions, and so we're going to be talking about things like baptizing robots, the Shroud of Turin, cryptids like the Jersey Devil, de-extincting animals, and things like that.
Well, that sounds like a perfect Jimmy Akin. That combination of four topics is that's very representative of your range.
Mm-hmm.
888-318-7884. A bunch of people on
there. You go.
You like that better? I should sing it.
Nice slow presentation of the number.
Yes. You know what? I got a song stuck in my head the last time you were here. Slow down.
Uh-huh.
I didn't remember all the words that you had, but I. Mm-hmm. I did have that song stuck in my head.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, I worked it out in advance because I realized that it could be used. So the words, for people who may wonder, you know, Cy has a tendency to say the phone number kind of fast sometimes.
Kind of.
Slow down, you move too fast. You got to make the phone number last. Just ticking off the digits then. And on Thursdays, the music's groovy.
I love that last part. In honor of that fine performance, 888-318-7884. Jimmy, I'm going to go to the phones, but before that, because Carlo's right here in the studio watching me right now, before we went on the air, I actually corrected a mistake that Carlo made. I've never done that before. I corrected it, and he said, "Thank you for telling me that. I'm glad you told me before I told anyone important." And I said, "You told me." And he... sorry, Carlo. He's mad at me now. 888-318.
No, he said, "That's good. That's he's learning the banter. That's good."
Exactly. 7884. Olivia. Sorry, Carlo. First of all, how proud am I that I corrected a mistake of Carlo Broussard? I mean,
how proud are you?
I'm feeling pretty big for my britches right now.
Uh huh. Get bigger britches.
I'm just going to start
maybe some stretch ones.
I might start doing some fasting, Jimmy. Olivia,
yeah, I've been doing that.
In Michigan, listening on the Catholic Answers app. Thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Olivia, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, Jimmy. Thank you for taking my call. I wanted to say I love you guys, first off.
Oh, thank you. I'm throwing myself in there with that, so thank you.
So I have a question about interpreting a passage from the first letter of Timothy. I'm a little bit confused at what Paul's trying to say here. I don't know. I don't understand his point.
Okay.
So he's talking about conduct in the church, and he says, "I do not permit a woman to teach or to have authority over a man, for Adam was formed first, then Eve. Further, Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and transgressed." At first blush, it sounds like he's saying that women shouldn't be leaders or teachers, but we know that that's not true because we have women leading and teaching, right? We have Judge Deborah, and then we have Priscilla and her husband Aquila teaching Apollos in the Book of Acts. Mm-hmm. So what is Paul actually getting at here?
He's talking not about about functional teaching or functional leadership, where he's talking, as you've correctly identified, he's talking specifically about what happens in church. And so that wouldn't apply, for example, to Deborah the judge, because she wasn't in church when she was leading Israel. I mean, she was a warlord, and so she was a leader in the secular sphere, protecting Israel against its enemies. So she's not exercising leadership in church, and neither was Priscilla. Priscilla was a very gifted woman, and she was teaching, but it was informally. She wasn't an officer of the church teaching the way a priest does. And so essentially, St. Paul is discussing official functions such that are exercised by the clergy, and specifically people who are priests or bishops. And that's really what he's concerned about, is that because of God's choice, which is manifest to us through Jesus Christ in picking only apostles as men, the church has felt bound by it ever since to reserve the priesthood to men. Paul also appeals here to early Genesis, where he draws some lessons from early Genesis that he considers relevant to this question. But that's essentially what he's talking about. It's not saying that women can't be catechists or that women can't be theologians. It's just saying they can't be the kind of teacher that a priest or bishop is. And similarly, they can't exercise the kind of leadership that that a priest or bishop does in church, but they can be leaders in other contexts. They can be warlords, they can be business leaders, they can be political leaders. It's just the hierarchical members of the clergy that by Christ's choice has been restricted to men. And even then, not all men. Most men don't become priests and bishops. It's a small minority of them that do.
Okay, Olivia?
So would you say that Paul is using a story from Genesis as sort of a metaphor for church to...
I'm going to let Jimmy try to answer, but you're breaking up, Olivia. So you was Paul using a story from Genesis to do what?
As a metaphor to compare the church to a family.
Well, that's an interesting way of looking at it. I wouldn't rule that out, but I haven't had a chance to think about the limits to which Paul is conceiving of this as a family. But I think Paul himself, based on things he says elsewhere, would find that family parallel resonates with him.
Olivia, thanks. I hope that was helpful. Thank you very much for the call and for the question. We go now to Karen in New Jersey, listening on 89.3 FM. Karen, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, and thank you. I appreciate it. My question is, why are we not doing online confession at this 2022 year?
Mm-hmm. So there are a couple of reasons. One of them, even if it's possible to do online confession, one reason is because we haven't had the internet for more than 30 years. I mean, it became available for the first time commercially in the 1990s, and the church is very cautious, and it doesn't endorse every new use of a technology, especially when it comes to something like a sacrament, because we've had the sacraments for 2,000 years. We have all of that tradition supporting an in-person use of the sacraments, and the internet is very new, so there hasn't been a lot of thought devoted to whether it's even possible to do this over the internet. Now, there is some precedent, because even though we haven't had the internet for very long, we have had telephones for very long. And I'm aware of some theologians in the 20th century who discussed whether it's possible to confess over a telephone. And even before that, we had letters And there has been some discussion historically of whether you could do confession through letters in what would be called epistolary form. And the general opinion, the church doesn't have a teaching on this, but the general theological opinion has been that it's not possible to do confession except in person, because the sacraments require a certain kind of personal presence. And so you can't like baptize someone by proxy, or you can't confirm someone by proxy. They need to be physically there for those sacraments. But you could argue, and so that's the common theological opinion, is that you need personal presence for that. But you could mount a counter case and say, well, actually, maybe it would be possible, because even though you can't baptize someone by proxy, or you can't confirm someone by proxy, you can get married by proxy. And the church recognizes that you can deputize someone to be your proxy and go to the celebration of the sacrament of holy matrimony, and they can exchange matrimonial consent on your behalf. And so that is a situation where you don't have to be personally present for the sacrament to be valid. And proxy marriage is even written into the code of canon law. So the church definitely says that's possible. And you could say, well, confession is similar to matrimony in that it involves an exchange of information. In the sacrament of matrimony, you exchange the information that, yes, I consent to be married to you. And in confession, then the other person reciprocates, I also consent to be married to you. And you don't need personal presence for that. Well, the sacrament of confession is the other sacrament that doesn't require you to have any like substance or body part that's involved. You simply need to communicate information. These are my sins, I repent of them, and then you're absolved. And so I can see an argument, and I'm aware of at least one theologian in the 20th century, in the 1930s, as a matter of fact, who advocated that it would be possible to do confession by telephone, presumably on that basis, that, well, you're exchanging information on the telephone, and therefore you're able to exchange the information in both directions, and so this should be valid. Now, that's not the common historical opinion, but it is one that I can see, and it's one that, you know, has an argument that you can make in favor of it, but thus far the church hasn't endorsed that. It hasn't condemned it either, but it hasn't endorsed it. And the general practice has been the traditional one of you want to be in person. There's also a third reason why why I think the church hasn't or wouldn't want to endorse it, at least at this point, which is the internet is not secure. The church takes the seal of confession very seriously, and there are all kinds of possibilities for electronic interception and recording of anything you say online. So if you go to confession online, the NSA knows all of your sins. If you're using Zoom, the Chinese Communist Party knows all of your sins. You can be subject to blackmail. You can be subject to exposure. And it would be really hard to defend the seal of confession in an online environment.
Karen, I got to leave it there. I hope that was helpful to you. There was a lot to consider there. We got to take our break, though, so we'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin right after this.
We're here for you. Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Hi, I'm Kristalina Everett, and I am so blessed to have a great new show on EWTN Radio. It's called Women Made New, where women help women get closer to God. Through honest conversations with our guests about the challenges we face in our lives, we're reminded that no matter what mistakes we've made, it's never too late to start over when we receive healing from the God who makes all things new. That's Women Made New every Saturday at 12 noon Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin, our guest. You are welcome to call 888-318-7884 with your question. And you can ask about just about anything when Jimmy's here. And so I look forward to your questions. David in Maryland is next, listening on the EWTN app. David, thank you for your call. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
I had a question about just measurements of time. Does the year in the Old Testament the same as the year that we measure now? Because Abraham was very old, and at that point, if it's different when they were in the desert, Moses, for 40 years, was it really 40 years in our time or 40 years differently?
Yeah, and this is something that people commonly ask about, especially with the patriarchs before the time of Abraham. They have these really, really long lifespans that are attributed to them. And so I've known people who have proposed, well, maybe a year meant something different. So maybe instead of saying that Methuselah lived to almost 1,000 years, maybe he lived to 1,000 months instead of 1,000 years or something like that. And it's understandable that people would try a strategy like that, but it really doesn't. I mean, it's a good thing to wonder about. It's a good question to ask. But when you do follow up on it, it turns out that it doesn't really work, because even if you propose some other length for what a year was, you're going to run into problems immediately in the patriarchal genealogies, because they don't just give the age of the patriarch at his death, they also give his age at which he became a father. And so even if you said, well, really a year is a month, and so we can divide these years by 12, you're going to have to divide the age of fatherhood by 12 as well, and you're going to get ridiculously young ages in some cases. Also, what you find if you map them out on a graph is that the ages of the patriarchs start really high, and they kind of gently swoop down to a more normal lifespan over the course of a number of generations. And that would imply that if you want to go with this a year is not a year theory, that the rate of measurement of the years was continuously changing. Either that, or you'd have to say some of these patriarchs, if you start with a year equals a month at the beginning, then some of these patriarchs didn't live very long. You know, like Abraham, it says he was 175. Well, he didn't live 175 months. And so how do you explain this gradual decline in the ages? You'd have to propose that the year is changing, and that renders the concept of timekeeping with a year irrelevant if you're constantly changing the rate at which you mark a year. What we find in looking at the patriarchal narratives, and I'll get to Moses in a minute, but what we find in the patriarchal narratives is that this was actually, if you compare it to other ancient Near Eastern literature, it was very common to attribute really long ages to figures in distant history, to the patriarchs of any given nation. It was very common to attribute fantastically long ages to them, and it seems to have been a symbol of their greatness. So it's not like they literally lived that long, but to show how great these figures were, we attribute to them this really long age. And in the case of the Genesis genealogies, it's been proposed that one of the factors affecting the ages that are attributed to some of the patriarchs is actually astronomy. And so there's a kind of astronomical symbolism that's being incorporated into these ages. And the most obvious example of that is the patriarch Enoch, who lived for the attribution is that he lived for 365 years. And that is identical, that number, 365, is identical to the number of days in a solar year. And so it's very easy to say, okay, well, it looks like Enoch has an astronomically determined year, astronomically determined age. And some scholars have proposed that if you look carefully at the numerical patterns in the other patriarchs, that they're also tied to astronomical phenomenon. And so one proposal is that these ages involve a kind of astronomical symbolism to communicate the greatness of the ancients. And I think whether you buy the astronomical aspect of that or not, I think that that's likely true, that most scholars of various stripes, liberal and conservative, have looked at these ages and said, okay, they're not meant to be taken literally. There's some kind of symbol. Now, when we come to things like Moses and spending 40 years in the desert, if you look at Moses's life, you see it kind of goes in different, in like three 40-year chunks. And so he's up to 40 when he goes, when he leaves Egypt, and then he spends 40 years before the Exodus, and then he spends 40 years in the in the wilderness. And 40, if you study the entire Bible, was a very special number in Hebrew culture. It was often used as a kind of stock number that symbolized a full period of time. So 40 days is like a lengthy period of days, and 40 years is a lengthy period of years. And it's also a round number. You know, if you're using, Hebrews tended to use 40 rather than 41 or 39. So it's like they're rounding numbers off that are nearby to 40 to just 40. And in some cases, it looks like 40 is just a stock number that represents a long period of time. So if you don't know how long precisely something lasted, you could just say, oh, it lasted for 40 years. Or if you don't know precisely how many days something was, whether it was, you know, 35 or 45, or you're not sure, you just say it was 40 days. And so, it looks like some of these years, especially in the earlier parts of the Bible, like Genesis and Exodus, numbers were not precisely being kept track of because they didn't have, you know, census bureaus and things like that, and birth certificates and death certificates and things like that. And so there's a certain amount of estimation and rounding and stock numbers, and in the case of the oldest patriarchs, symbolism going on.
I'm going to leave it there. Thank you very, very much for the question. Appreciate that. I hope it was helpful to you. We're going to go to Austin in New York now, watching on YouTube. It's open forum. Jimmy Akin is our guest. Austin, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, my question is, what kind of soul would a single cell organism have?
Well, so the standard account would say that souls, this is a theological way of looking at this that theologians have been doing, you know, all the way through Christian history. It ultimately goes back to Aristotle. Aristotle talked about the different kinds of souls that things have, and then the medievals picked that up and talked about different ways it could work. But basically, to identify the kind of soul that something has, you look at the functions that an organism displays. And so they looked at plants, and the typical plant has the ability to take in nutrients, so it has the faculty of nutrition. It also is able to reproduce itself, so it has the faculty of reproduction, and it has the ability to just in general maintain itself, to metabolize and live. And since plants had that kind of soul, you would the medievals would say they have vegetative souls, because that's what a vegetable or a plant is able to do. An animal, though, has a typical animal has some additional abilities. It has the ability to sense its environment, and like, you know, dogs and cats, they can see things and hear things and smell things. And so they have sensation, and they have the ability to move around in their environment. They have motility. Now, there are weird cases in both the plant kingdom and the animal kingdom, like a Venus flytrap is able to move in a way most plants can't. You know, it can snap closed on its prey, like an insect. On the other hand, there are animals that don't fit the normal animal model, like sea sponges. sea sponges don't look like they have much sensation. They don't have much more ability than a plant to sense what's going on in their environment. And they're sessile. They don't move. They're rooted to one spot. And so they don't have mobility either. So there are some weird cases, but those would be the way the medievals looked at this based on observation at the time. So when we come back from the break, we'll talk about microbes, which the ancients didn't know about.
Austin, hang on if you would for just a couple minutes and we'll come back to find out what kind of soul a single cell organism does have. Any, as you can guess by Austin's question, any question welcome, 888-31-TRUTH. Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you. Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
The Eucharist is the greatest gift we have.
How much do you love Jesus and the Blessed Sacrament?
We'll talk about that tomorrow on Take Two with Jerry and Debbie on most of these EWTN stations.
Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
So glad we didn't give up the groovy music for Lent. You know, people give up good things for Lent, and I'm glad we didn't give up the groovy music, though. Thanks, Zach. Jimmy Akin is our guest, and we're Austin in New York called and said, "What kind of soul does a single cell organism have?" And Jimmy, you were explaining the kind of ancient observational way of thinking about souls, like what can the thing do, and that tells us what kind of soul it has.
Yeah, and then the medievals would put these, you know, based on prior Greek thought, would put these into broad categories of animal, of vegetative souls and sensitive souls for animals, and then humans, because we have the gift of reason, they would say we have a rational soul because we display that faculty. Well, part of the those can be useful as broad categories, but they don't fit every case. Like we were talking about, some animals like sponges do not have mobility, even though that's normally considered part of what an animal soul does. Other and other creatures like Venus flytraps do have a kind of visible mobility and an ability to sense their environment, because that's how they know when they need to close. If a fly has flown into a Venus flytrap, it's got a sense of touch, and it feels that, and that's what tells it to close up. So there are plants that seem to have animal attributes that are like an animal soul, even though they're plants. And so I think these broad categories of vegetative and sensitive souls are useful but they don't fit every case. And so when we look at single-celled organisms, well, lots of single-celled organisms, they have very primitive senses. They obviously can take in nutrition because and they can metabolize it so they can stay alive, and they can reproduce themselves. So they definitely have the attributes we'd ascribe to a vegetative soul. They can do the kinds of things that plants do. But they also seem to be able to do some additional things. Some of them can sense their environment. For example, various pathogens, bacteria, let's say, that are in your body, you can have some dangerous bacteria in your body that aren't harming you because they don't become active and start harming you until they sense that there are enough of them in you to actually make you sick. This is called quorum sensing. If they sense we've got a quorum of us, of our type of bacteria, we're going to go active. And if we don't have a quorum, we're not going to go active. And so that would indicate that that some single-celled organisms have an ability to sense their environment chemically, let's say, which is effectively the sense of smell. It's chemical sensing. Also, they can move around. They've got these little cilia that they can wiggle, and dinoflagellates have these tails. They can wiggle around and propel themselves in their environment, and that's motility. And both environment sensing and motility are normally ascribed to animals. So you could propose that, well, these are little animals, and they've got that. In fact, Christian Huygens, who was looked at them through a microscope for the first time, called them animalcules, meaning tiny little animals. And he was a scientist in Holland, if I remember correctly, in the 1600s. And so you could propose they're little animals, and so they've got sensitive souls like other animals. Or you could say, you know, maybe we need to make up a new broad category of souls. You could call them the microbe soul or something like that to reflect the characteristics that they typically have. But one way or another, I think that these broad categories are merely tools of convenience. Since the soul is the form of a creature's body, it gives it all of its different abilities. Really, each species of animal has a different kind of soul. So a dog soul is not the same as a cat soul because dogs are different than cats. And you can lump them both into the category of animal and say, well, they've got sensitive souls. But really, it's more fine-grained than that. Dogs have a soul that gives it a specific set of characteristics that make it a dog. Cats have a soul that gives it a specific set of characteristics that make it a cat. And the anthrax bacillus has a soul that gives it a specific set of characteristics that make it anthrax rather than malaria.
Austin, thank you very, very much for that question. It's open forum, and you're welcome to call with whatever question you have. Eileen, you can call 888-318-7884. Once again, Eileen. 888-318-7884.
Gold star, Si.
What's that?
Gold star.
Gold star for going slow? Yeah. Because Eileen called and said, could you please tell Si to slow down when giving out the number? Yes, Eileen. Thank you very much. Jimmy tells me it all the time, and it seems to have only a temporary effect. It's like Popeye's spinach.
You need booster doses.
I need booster doses, exactly. I want to just read a question that Laura in San Antonio couldn't stay on the phone to ask. She was listening on Guadalupe Radio. Why does the priest remove a small piece of the Eucharist and place it into the chalice during Mass?
It has a couple of different meanings. Originally, this was done to show the communion between different churches. So you would have let's say you're in the Church of Alexandria, and you want to show that you're in communion with a nearby church, let's say in Leontopolis. Both of those are in Egypt. And so what the two churches would do is they would take consecrated hosts and exchange them. And and this would show that they were in communion with each other. And eventually this became impractical or fell out of use to actually exchange the hosts. And so what they would do is they would a priest would break off a little piece of his own host to do this, and then by placing it in the chalice, in the precious blood, it symbolizes the resurrection of Christ, because in Christ's death, his body and blood were separated, and in the resurrection, they're put back together. And so by uniting the body of Christ, now really the whole Jesus is there in both the host and under the form of wine, but by reuniting the precious blood with the host, or piece of the host, it signifies the reuniting of Christ's body and blood in his resurrection.
All right. Thanks, Laura, for that question. We go now to Germantown, Ohio. Michael, listening on Sacred Heart Radio in Germantown. You're next, Michael. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, guys. Just wanted to ask you a bit of a question that I've not really heard anyone speak about. So the church teaches that when you are cremated, that you must keep the ashes together, that they cannot be separated. But I've read that in regards to someone wanting to donate an organ or their body to science, that is allowed, provided afterwards the remains are collected and either buried or then cremated. My question is, what happens when someone makes a mistake and they don't bring the remains together to cremate and or bury them in a Catholic cemetery or place them in a columbarium? I'm just kind of curious what a person's soul would, I guess, incur for not having those body parts brought back together, unbeknownst of their own capability to do so.
Well, so this is a situation where let's say you die and you go to heaven, and let's say you pass through purgatory first and you go to heaven, and then someone forgets to get your remains back from the lab and inter them properly. Well, obviously what happens in that case is, even though you're in heaven, you are a saint now. God says to you, I'm sorry, there was a lab mistake. You now have to go to hell.
Wait.
And not only, but because you came through purgatory, you're going to have to go back to purgatory and re-suffer for all of the sins that you got purified there before you go to hell and get purified even more. And then at the resurrection on the last day, you don't get your body back because it wasn't properly interred in a Catholic cemetery. And so you're just going to be a ghost in hell for all eternity with no body.
I am fairly certain that is not correct.
You would be correct to be certain, Cy, because it is not correct. What happens with your body on earth after you've gone to heaven is irrelevant to what happens to your soul. And so a lab mistake cannot damn you to hell or keep you out of heaven. It's also not going to stop God at the resurrection, because God has people whose bodies are in much worse condition than it ended up, you know, part of it ended up pickled in a jar in a lab. As Genesis says, dust you are, and to dust you shall return. People's bodies fall apart into very tiny pieces. I mean, they get scattered on the molecular scale unless they're embalmed, and that's not going to stop God from resurrecting people. And so God has created all this matter in the first place. He knows where it all is. I mean, he says the very hairs of our head are numbered, and so he knows where every molecule in the universe is, and he can pull together whatever he needs to resurrect you and resupply you with a body at the resurrection. What determines your fate is God and his grace and how you cooperated with his grace, not what happened with the laboratory filing system.
Michael, thank you for the question. I got nervous there for a second, but I'm feeling much better now. We've got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum. Jimmy Akin, Catholic Answers Live, right after this.
Hello, this is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Keep your dial tuned to Catholic Answers Live.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
What a great grace it is to have the opportunity to use the airwaves for the honor and glory of God, to be able to talk to the hearts of individuals and meet them where they are in their relationship with our Lord, and also to encourage them forward.
Women of Grace with Johnette Williams, this morning, 3 a.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Here's the ad Carrie told me to read. Let's see if it includes the words, "What are you waiting for?" It's March, and you know what that means. Lent is here, and oh yeah, shop.catholic.com is kicking off our spring sale, store-wide sale. Everything is marked down 10 to 25% and more. Hundreds of great Catholic resources just a click away at shop.catholic.com, and make sure you sign up for your Catholic Answers rewards, your way to get free stuff. So many ways to save. Shop.catholic.com. It did not include Carrie's usual phrase, "What are you waiting for?"
Maybe he's gotten wise to you and is mixing it up to keep you on your toes.
That is exactly what Carrie would do. Brian in Columbus, Ohio, you're up next with Jimmy Akin, listening on St. Gabriel Radio. Brian, thanks for the call. Go ahead with the question.
Well, thank you. I have a question about paradise. It seems that really from Scripture, the only people who really know for sure that were in paradise was Lucifer and Adam and Eve. And it didn't. If it's supposed to be this perfect state of being and fulfillment, why wasn't it good enough for them?
Well, so this is something that we can't ultimately answer because Scripture doesn't explore this. And we also should be aware that the Church recognizes that this part of Genesis, including Genesis 3, which is the account of the fall, uses figurative language. And so it teaches us a real set of truths, but it's framed in a narrative form that is figurative. And so we shouldn't assume that, for example, there was literally the devil was in the form of a talking snake, or that literally there was a particular tree that if you eat it, it's going to increase your knowledge level. Instead, if you look, for example, in encyclicals of John Paul II and other things that John Paul II talked about, and in the Catechism for that matter, it acknowledges that these are symbols of an event where our first parents turned away from God and violated the boundaries that God had set on human existence, morally speaking, which is represented by the figure of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And similarly, we don't have to think the devil literally appeared as a snake, and that's literally why snakes don't have legs and go on their bellies. This is a symbol of the devil and tempting man. So, having said that, we can't really know fully why they wouldn't have wanted to be content with their lot. One of the truths of sin makes you stupid, and sin is not rational. And they had what we can infer is they had some kind of desires that they did not see as being met, and they then chose to try to pursue the fulfillment of those desires, even though it meant that they would lose their privileged form of existence. And we needn't think of this phase of human history as being idyllic. I mean, really, you look at what Genesis says, it doesn't, it does, I mean, there have been theologians who proposed, okay, like Adam and Eve had superpowers and they were invulnerable and they could fly to the moon instantly just by thinking about it and all this kind of stuff. And none of that is in Genesis. It doesn't present Adam and Eve as having superpowers. It just says, look, there is this man and there's this woman and they lived in a garden where they got free food, eating fruit in exchange for tending the garden. So they were gardeners. And that's really all it says. And that doesn't, but you can imagine how, okay, there are gardeners today who get paid by, okay, you get to, you get your free room and board and you do your work, you keep this garden, you know, this, you keep this ground up, you're a groundskeeper, and they can have unmet desires. And what Genesis presents to us as the unmet desire that Eve had was knowledge, that she recognized that the and also a culinary experience, because it says that when the serpent tempted her, that Eve recognized that the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil was beautiful to look at, so it was attractive. There was a sensory, sensual, ooh, I'd like to eat that, just like a culinary experience. You go to a restaurant, this food smells really good, it's plated really well, it looks gorgeous, and you want to eat it. And it was also beneficial, she recognized, for gaining wisdom. So it had this other benefit. So Eve had these sensory-based desires based on the appearance of the fruit, and she had a desire to gain in wisdom. And presumably Adam did too, because he went along with all this. So those are the ones that the text presents to us as their unmet desires, but it we shouldn't really take that literally, because we know this text incorporates a lot of figurative imagery, and it's really teaching us truth on a deeper level.
Brian, thanks. Thanks very much. It is open forum, and we will continue next hour with open forum because there's lots of folks on the line. Mark Brumley will be here second hour, so hang on if we don't get to you this hour, but still, we got lots of opportunity to get to calls this hour. Jimmy Akin is our guest. I was not aware of the theologians who proposed they could fly to the moon.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
It's called the gift of agility.
Oh.
You could just teleport anywhere you want.
I think if you could, you'd end up not doing it. And here's why I think so. Because I live in San Diego, and people always come and go, how often do you go to the San Diego Zoo? And I'm like, never. And it's because we live here. It's because I don't know. You know, so.
You know, there's an episode of Futurama where you have this 20th century guy in the 30th century, and he insists his 30th century friends, like, take him to the edge of the universe.
Yeah.
Where they have those little coin-operated telescopes you can look out. And as they're there, and he's oogling over the fact, I'm looking out of the edge of the universe, they're going, you know, you live in the universe, you never think to go to a place like this.
That's exactly it. So I think if you could fly to the moon, you'd be like, I don't know, I'm going to stay in tonight. Jesus in El Paso, Texas, watching on YouTube. You're next, Jesus. Go ahead with your question.
Okay, hi. Hi. Just a small clarification here. Oh, okay, and the fourth sorrowful mystery, as Jesus has been led to Calvary, men and women are lamenting over his the treatment, and he says to them to not lament for him, to lament for themselves, you know, and this is a reference to the women who have not borne, the wombs that have not borne children, and the breasts that have not been suckled will cry to the mountains to fall on them and for the hills to cover them.
Okay.
What I would like clarification on is the sentence that says, for if this is what is done to green wood, what will be done to when the wood is dry? This is what is puzzling. You know.
Yeah, okay, so what does that mean?
So Jesus is using an analogy here, and the analogy is between when a tree is living and healthy, and so it's got green wood, and when the tree is like withered up and dry and dead. And if he's saying essentially, if bad things are happening now, when things are going well, and we're in a functional situation that's broadly speaking healthy and okay and so forth, what's going to happen in the future when we're further along and we're in a situation that is not healthy and that is not functioning well? And what he's specifically thinking about, because this is Jesus' most famous prophecy other than his own resurrection, is that the temple is going to be destroyed. The Romans are going to come in and they're going to destroy the temple. And that happened in AD 70. But there was a war that preceded that. And the war began in AD 66. And at first, the Jewish nation had some success in fighting the Romans. But then it went really bad. And then it went horrifically bad. And we have an account from the Jewish historian Josephus of just how bad it got in Jerusalem when the Romans were besieging the city. I mean, you had instances of cannibalism and cannibalism within individual families that are so horrific, I'm not even going to describe them. Jesus is essentially analogizing his situation to that and that of the women, because he says this is going to happen within a generation. And so right now we're in this healthy situation. The nation of Israel is functional. It's robust. It's healthy. We've got the temple going. Everything is, on one level, seems to be okay. And yet he is suffering this horrific act. He's being led to his own crucifixion. And yeah, you might feel sorrowful for him, but really you need to also be aware of what's coming for you. Because if I'm being crucified in a healthy situation, then the coming situation where the nation is going to be withered as a result of all the warfare, you're going to have a lot to suffer too. And in fact, Josephus talks about how during the siege of Jerusalem, the Romans just crucified huge numbers of people. And people did have extreme stress. And it was particularly hard on mothers, you know, who had children they needed to be responsible for. And so that's essentially what Jesus is talking about here.
Jesus, does that satisfy you?
Also, reference to the third secret, maybe, I don't, you know, it's just a thought came,
no,
ahead, came
no,
to me about
there's,
that.
This has nothing to do with the third secret of Fatima. Jesus is talking about a situation that existed in the first century within 40 years of his own crucifixion. He is not talking about the events of the third secret of Fatima, which happened in the 20th century.
I'm going to say thanks, Jesus, because I tried to get one more person in. John in Puerto Rico, listening on the Catholic Answers app. Thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Go ahead, John, with your question for Jimmy.
Yeah, thanks for having me. So my question for Jimmy would be pertaining to Numbers 31, if I'm not mistaken, where the command is given to slaughter the Midianites. You know, when you're defending the faith to a lot of people, to say the people who are more knowledgeable than the average person, they would, you know, cite these passages as sort of objections, you know, moral objections to the faith. And so what the main thing that people would, you know, because you can explain, you know, the command and the slaughter, you can justify that with God's sovereignty, but the thing that most people have an issue with is when it says to slaughter everybody, but when Moses tells them to slaughter everybody except the little girls that have not known a man by lying with them, it says in the passage to take them for yourselves. And the problems people have,
it doesn't
have
say
with that
do
the,
take them. It doesn't say do take them for yourselves. It says that you may.
Okay, so Jimmy, I don't have a lot of time to go back and forth. So what does
no,
it mean?
No, and this is the problem. I don't have enough time to answer this question in a reasonable way.
Yeah.
It's too complex. It involves too many issues.
Oh, I gotcha.
So I'm sorry about that. John, if you want, call again when I'm on the show, and we'll try to get you on earlier in the hour so that I can have time to actually interact with your question.
Yeah, thanks, John. And I apologize for that, because I really should have been attentive to that, that this was a question that was going to require a good deal of time. So we do want you to call. We do want you to ask the question, but you have to do it earlier in the show next time. Jimmy, thank you very, very much. I appreciate it.
My pleasure.
And tomorrow, Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World is Patron Questions, everything from Chupacabra to the Shroud of Turin.
Stuff like that, yeah.
Everything in between.
Jersey Devil, actually.
Oh, the Jersey Devil, yeah. Coming up next, Mark Brumley. So if you're on the line, stay on the line. If you haven't called yet, there will be a few lines open. 888-318-7884. 888-318-7884. Open forum. Call and ask whatever you like. And it's open to anybody. You don't have to be Catholic. You don't have to be Christian. We'd love to talk with you if you've got a question about the Catholic faith. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. It's still open forum. So you can ask whatever you like, whether you're Catholic or not, about the Catholic faith. You want to know about the sacraments, about the Bible, about the popes. You want to know about Jesus himself. You are welcome to call 888-318-7884. This hour, yes, as promised, we welcome the president of the greatest publishing house. You're looking skeptical again, Mark, in the Alpha Quadrant, Mark Brumley, president of Ignatius Press. Hi, Mark.
Hey, I am so happy with you, Cy. It's really busy here trying to manage things over the Alpha Quadrant. Big region.
Big quadrant, but you got big things planned for it. Huge.
Absolutely. We got quite a email campaign for the Alpha Quadrant.
Have you got any books you want to tell me about today? Like, some days you don't come with a book that you're ready to talk about, and some days you do. I don't know. Do you have
I was thinking about that because Father Fessio and Vivian Doudreau and Joseph Piers have the Formed Book Club, which is an Ignatius Press book discussion on the Formed platform, but it's also available on YouTube and other places like that. And they're talking about The City of God. I actually have a production copy. That's why it says production copy for those who are watching this.
Oh, yeah.
And this is The City of God by St. Augustine, but it's selections and introduction by Hans-Urs von Balthasar. So I've been reading through that anyway, and it was great to coincide with the launch. I was reading it before, but then they started reading it for the book club. And so I've been reading kind of along with it. So I highly recommend this. This is a classic, but, you know, usually it comes in an edition that's about, I don't know, five times as big. So this is an edited, selected edition, and which means that if you start reading it, there's like a much better chance you'll actually read the whole thing.
Yeah, yeah, so. Right. I find the older I get, the chances are lower on any given book. I really want to get the odds up higher.
This is great. Little selections of different aspects of St. Augustine. What am I talking about? It's a city in Florida. St. Augustine, I used to call him St. Augustine when I was a Protestant, you know.
I think a lot of people still say St. Augustine. Are we Philistines, those of us who say Augustine?
No. It's okay. It's an alternative translation, or way of pronouncing it. But it's more common, at least in many Catholic circles, to say Augustine. St. Augustine, but you can say Augustine if you want. Just don't say Augustine. So it's The City of God.
Augustine. Okay.
Yeah, and we also have Ignatius' critical edition of the Confessions of St. Augustine.
Nice. Augustine. Did other people write books this long in the olden days? He writes very long books.
Yeah, well, Confessions is actually not that long. It looks thicker because this is a critical edition, which means not only you have the text, but you have a lot of introduction and essays in the back talking about the text. But The City of God is a big book. He wrote it over the course of 15 years.
Yeah.
And it's dealing with the issue of the fall of the Roman Empire, or at least the beginning of the process of the so-called fall or collapse of the Roman Empire.
Right.
You know, what happens? You got pagan Rome for all those years, and it's very successful, becomes an empire and all of that. Then Christianity is legalized and then becomes the official religion, and you have Rome sacked, and then all kinds of bad things happen. So the argument from the pagans was, well, it's because we all became Christians.
Yeah.
The Roman gods protected us. Now that we're all Christians, or you guys are Christians anyway, look at all the bad things happening in the empire. So the City of God is kind of somewhat of an apologetic in response that deals with lots of other issues, but that's sort of the apologetical thread. This is an apologetic show. You know?
Yeah. All right. Well, and so so the book is cities. You can just go to Ignatius.com and look up City of God, and you'll find it.
Absolutely.
All right. The number is 888-318-7884. Mark Brumley is our guest, and I feel like there was one other thing I was going to cover with you, but I can't think of it, so I'm going to go to the phones.
Well, we could do that.
That's
what we're here for.
Virtually everyone listening to the program is relieved when I go, let's go to the phones. They're like, finally.
Yeah, because they've been waiting.
He's done talking. That guy is done talking. Michael in Atlanta, Georgia. I don't know where listening, maybe on The Quest in Atlanta, Georgia, the big Catholic radio station down there. Michael, go ahead with your question.
Hello, Kent. Am I on?
Oh, yeah, yeah, you're on the air with Mark Brumley.
Okie dokie. Okie dokie. I think the last time I called, I didn't go through for some reason, but that's okay. Actually, I'm listening I was watching on the Facebook, Facebook Live. So
I'm waving to you right now.
Let's see, are you delayed?
Yeah, I mean, yes, there is a delay. Don't watch it. It'll confuse you.
Yeah, they told me that. That's why they told me not to put it up. But anyway, the question I have, it's a biblical question, because I came across this passage, 1 Corinthians 15:29, which Paul writes, "Now if there's no resurrection, what will that do for those who are baptized for the dead? If the dead are not raised, why are people baptized for them?" I figure that our Mormon brethren use that as their justification for their proxy baptisms of their family members gone before. But what is the Catholic interpretation of baptism for the dead?
Mark?
Oh, very good. Well, first of all, yes, this is in 1 Corinthians. I think you gave the reference, 1 Corinthians 15. Context is, well, let me read what the verse says. Verse 29, "Otherwise, what do people mean by being baptized on behalf of the dead? If the dead are not raised at all, why are people baptized on their behalf?" So Paul's dealing with the question of the resurrection from the dead. He's saying, you go back to verse 12, he says there's some people that are going around preaching that there is no resurrection of the dead. Because now if Christ is preached as raised from the dead, how can some say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ hasn't been raised. If Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. And later he says, you're still in your sins. If Christ is not raised, you're still in your sins. So that's a context for this. It's a discussion of the resurrection of Jesus. Paul responding to people who claim there is no resurrection of the dead. And so he's appealing to the example of Jesus being raised from the dead to underscore the fact that there is a resurrection from the dead. And he talks about several other things here, but then he comes down to verse 29. So now he's appealing to the practice of what's referred to here as being baptized on behalf of the dead in order to justify that there's a resurrection. So it's a perplexing text. As you say, Mormons sometimes appeal to it. Different interpretations that are sometimes given. One is that it's just an ancient practice that was outmoded, that some people were being baptized for their ancestors who didn't live during the time of Jesus, and so they would undergo baptism for those ancestors. Something akin to what Mormons do. Some people claim that this was an ancient practice in the church, not that Paul is approving it, but that he's referring to it. I don't find that all that persuasive because we see no other evidence of it anywhere else, and it just seems kind of odd. A second interpretation that's sometimes given is based upon the verses that follow. Paul goes on to say, why am I in peril every hour? I protest, brethren, by my pride in you, which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die every day. And then he goes on to talk about how he's suffering and so on and so forth. Well, it's hard to make sense of that in the context of the resurrection. Perhaps Paul is saying, when he speaks of people being baptized on the behalf of the dead, he's somehow referring to baptism in the sense of suffering. So it would be the idea that these people are suffering or enduring a baptism of suffering for the sake of other people. So those other people who are either physically dead, who died, or who are spiritually dead. So that's another interpretation. The one that I think is interesting, and I'm not quite sure whether I buy it or not, is that the idea here is that if Christ isn't raised from the dead, then the act of Christian baptism then becomes, in effect, a baptism on behalf of or in the interest of someone who's dead. if Christ is raised from the dead, then our being baptized is not just a baptism into his death, as Paul says in Romans chapter 5, but also a baptism into his resurrected life. So what Paul would be saying here when he speaks of baptism on behalf of the dead, he's saying if Christ isn't raised from the dead because there's no resurrection, then when we baptize into the name or into the person of Jesus, we're baptizing into someone who's still dead. What point, what sense would there be to that? What sense would we make of that? So Paul is not saying that there is such a thing as baptism on behalf of the dead in the sense of somebody who's alive being baptized in the interest of someone who's dead, but he's saying that Christ is raised from the dead. Otherwise, when we were engaging in the action of baptism, we'd be baptizing people in the interest of somebody who's dead instead of in the cause of someone who's resurrected. So that wouldn't make any sense, Paul is saying. So we don't know exactly what he's talking about, but I think of among those interpretations, I would be more inclined to go to the last one and not see this as pointing to some early Christian practice of baptism on behalf of dead people.
Michael, I'm going to leave it there and say thanks because we have to do our first break. Our guest is Mark Brumley, president of Ignatius Press. They've got a new edition out of The City of God. You can check that out at ignatius.com. We'll be right back with more questions for Mark after this.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I don't like looking back. I prefer to look forward and keep moving forward. There's plenty to cover. I do a lot of research and try to dig out the bits and pieces of a life or of an agenda that people don't want to talk about.
The World Over with Raymond Arroyo. Tonight, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Radio and Television.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. If you live in the Alpha Quadrant and you got questions about the Catholic faith, today's your day. Mark Brumley is here, president of Ignatius Press, 888-318-7884. I'm going to do that for Lent. I'm going to make that a Lent thing. I'm going to say the number slowly for Lent. What do you think? I've already done some other things. I don't want you to think, Mark, that that's the only thing I'm going to do for Lent.
Is this penance for you or penance for other people?
Well, I guess it's a discipline more, a discipline of charity, because everyone says I say the number so fast they can't hear it. Okay. So I'll discipline myself in charity so that people can get the phone number.
I think this is really, I mean, you're just saying it so fast. I think it's really your desire to be a disc jockey. And you know, they talk fast, and so that comes through when you're giving out the number. But I think it'd be charitable for you to slow it down.
All right, I will do that then. And I don't really want to be a disc jockey. I just want disc jockey money. I just want somebody to come through with disc jockey money. George in Iowa, listening on Iowa Catholic Radio, you are next, George. Go ahead with your question for Mark.
Thanks. So I was wondering this question's about what free will is and what kind of world that we live in. And it's possible to imagine the concept of God intervening today as, you know, in the past he did in the Bible and such. If God were to tell someone what their future was, hypothetically, whether it's the major beats of their life or the immediate details of what they're about to do. Does that mean that, informed with this information, a human would be, well, is there one future that someone is, even if they have information about it, they can't choose? A new future isn't opened up to them with that information.
Oh.
And they just become like a puppet that sees its strings, or is it possible that being informed of the future means that we are therefore free to choose a different future, like acting on that information?
All right, I'm going to guess at Mark's answer, and then I'm going to let him answer. Not puppet on the string, because God doesn't do that to us. But I'm just guessing. Mark, what do you say?
So if I'm following, the question is, if I had perfect knowledge of the future, would I feel compelled to act in a way to realize that? Or could I act in a different way and thus make a different future? Is that the question?
Sure, yeah. Whichever one it is.
I would say, well, I don't think that, you say, if I have perfect knowledge of the future, if it's really knowledge of the future, what is going to happen, not a possible future, but what the actual future is going to be, then I don't see how I could do something otherwise, because that's the future. If this is the actual future that's going to happen. But I think that it, I don't know that it's meaningful to talk about human beings having that kind of perfect knowledge of the future, because I think that there needs to be space for human freedom. So if I, it would seem that that kind of knowledge of the future for a human being would preclude a human being from having freedom. But I don't know if I've convinced Cy. He doesn't.
Let's put it this way. As a hypothetical, it seems to me that you're saying, as a hypothetical, if I know the future, I can't change the future, because then otherwise that would not be knowledge. But then you're following that by saying that hypothetical is not really possible for human beings, because that's not the kind of creatures we are, and that would eliminate our freedom.
Right.
Okay, then I totally dig what you said. What do you think about that, George?
Well, I've had those same thoughts as you have approaching this type of question. But the thing is, does that mean that logically God cannot choose to reveal that to us? Right? Doesn't that create an implication? Right? If the future has meaning, then therefore this thing cannot happen. But if you're outside of the universe, if you're outside of space and time, interacting with someone, there's something preventing you from doing that. Then that means, what does that mean? Is God the source? If God is the source of his own actions, then he should be able to do whatever he wants with a person. Show them the future, tell them something.
Well, anything that's logically consistent with the nature of the person. I mean, you.
Right.
But the nature of God. Yeah.
Well, but of the person, too.
We are nothing before God. Well, our will does not override what God can do.
All right, I'm going to let
Being outside of space and time is. That is right.
Power. But God can't make me be alive and dead at the same time in the same sense. God can't make me be 10 feet tall and 2 feet tall at the same time, and so on. So, you know, there are things that do have to do with consistency of the person we're talking about, the nature of the person. So it's not just a question of what God can do. It's also a question of what God has chosen to do, and therefore he can't behave in a contradictory way. But with respect to the future, if we're positing that we know something is the future, that I have knowledge that this is going to happen, and I am involved in the thing that's going to happen, then that degree of specificity would limit me from doing otherwise. If I could do otherwise, then I wouldn't be knowing the future. But when we have things like prophecies in the Bible, those prophecies lack the kind of specificity and clarity with respect to particular recipients of that message, of those messages, so that their freedom is not impeded. They don't know how certain things are going to come about. They only know that they're going to come about, and they, and therefore, when we talk about the future being involving a certain outcome, that's not in contradiction to people's freedom.
I think I'm going to leave it there. This is the kind of thing that I would talk about all day, but that would be unfair. But George, I thank you very much for the call. I hope that it has at least been somewhat helpful. Madison in Michigan, you are next watching on YouTube. Madison, go ahead with your question for Mark.
Hi there.
Hi, Madison.
Hey, thank you so much for taking my call. This is pretty cool. I love Catholic Answers. You guys do amazing work. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Madison. You can call anytime if you're going to say stuff like that.
Yeah, I will call all the time then.
Okay, good.
All right. So a few weeks ago, I was meditating on how there are at least a couple places in Scripture that I can recall where David is referred to as a man after God's own heart. And so that led me to think that in a way, David could be considered the first Sacred Heart devotee, if you will. And I brought this up to a fellow Catholic, and he kind of pushed back and said that since this was prior to the incarnation, that is an unreasonable statement. So I just wanted to see what your thoughts were on that. And I thought that it was especially fitting with the Sacred Heart devotion, since our Lord had allegedly said to St. Margaret Mary something to the effect of, that I set neither limit nor measure to the gifts of my grace for those who seek truth in my heart. And his whole point in pushing back was that God did not have a physical heart until the incarnation, but that the Sacred Heart devotion is more so about the mercy of God. So let me know what your thoughts are on that.
Well, I think your friend is right that the devotion of the Sacred Heart is focusing on the Sacred Heart of Jesus, and it has to do with the incarnate heart. We're not talking about the physical organ now. We're talking about the heart as the core of the person and what's at the core of Jesus in his humanity is his love for the Father, of course. But of course, he wants to do all that the Father wants of him. And why did the Father send the Son into the world? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. So Jesus came as incarnate mercy. So at the core of Jesus's humanity is this merciful love of the Father being expressed by his Son. So that's what's at the heart of Jesus. But the heart of Jesus touching on the person and not just the physical or the human nature, I should say, not just the human nature, but on the person, because the person is the one who is the who has the heart, right? That's the second person of the Blessed Trinity. And the second person of the Blessed Trinity receives all that he is from the Father. So there's a certain way in which we can speak of, behind the Sacred Heart of Jesus and Jesus' humanity is the divine heart of God. And so that goes back to your point about David being a man after God's own heart. Different ways we can understand that. When we say someone's a man after someone else's heart, we often mean by that someone who is like the other person or is devoted to the other person or is devoted to the things the other person is devoted to. And so David is a man after God's own heart in the sense that David is someone who's devoted to God and the things of God and what God's interested in. And so in that sense, we can also think of David as being someone who's passionate in bringing about what God wants to bring about and embodies what God wants and God desires. So if the heart of God and at the center of God or what's the way God relates to us, the deepest level of God's being is mercy and love and compassion for us, and that's what's behind the heart of Jesus, then we can in a certain sense say that David is a man after God's own heart, and that he is therefore, you know, at least in the biblical salvation history, as far as the term of heart goes, the first person that has kind of a devotion to the Sacred Heart, to the heart of God, and that he's driven by and passionate for what God wants.
Madison, how's that?
That's perfect. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much. It was also timed perfectly. Here comes the music. But I'd like to send you Mark's book, The Seven Deadly Sins of Apologetics, not because I think you're going to commit any of the deadly sins. I just want to give you a nice gift.
You want to help her help others not do it.
That's right. That's right. Help others not commit those seven. So hang on. If you'd like to get the copy of Mark's book, The Seven Deadly Sins of Apologetics, we'll send it to you. Thanks, Madison, for a very nice call. Right back with more Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
I do. It's beautiful. You do, man.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge
people.
By the
way,
we celebrate his birthday every
year.
It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
The Eucharist is the greatest gift we have.
How much do you love Jesus and the Blessed Sacrament?
We'll talk about that tomorrow on Take Two with Jerry and Debbie on most of these EWTN stations.
Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
It's Lent. Blessed Lent to you and to all of yours. But even in Lent, we play the groovy music. We don't give up on the groovy music.
It's groovy, groovy Lent, man.
That's groovy, groovy Lent right now, yeah. I don't know if you could tell, Mark, but during the break, the gentlemen in the booth over there were turning the lights on and off, doing a light show in here.
It's amazing.
I don't know if I can continue with the show.
I thought it was wonderful. I was having a religious experience.
Were you really? I was having something approaching a seizure, I think, under those. Are you guys done? Can we do the radio show now? Are we done?
I thought I was going to get the fifth secret of Fatima.
It kind of looked like that, huh? Like, or the McMahon, like, I don't know, like a man of the future. No, we said done. Don't start up again just because Mark starts up again. Let's see where we're going.
I like the way you just smoothly went over the fourth secret of Fatima. You know, I say the fifth secret. You don't even bring it. It's like, I don't even want to know what Brumley's talking about.
I'm sorry, Mark.
Let's get it back to the show, man.
I'm so sorry. They really did bother me with the lights. So I'm not on my game. And you know, my game is pretty low to start out with. We don't start at a high level. And then you upset me with a bunch of lights and...
Was this like Andromeda Strain moment? You get the reference there?
No, I don't.
The movie
okay, I think I've seen the Andromeda Strain, but
we don't want to go down that
rabbit hole. Do the astronauts bring something back to the Earth? Is that the Andromeda Strain?
No, a satellite. Or not a satellite. A space probe. comes back down, and yes, it has a deadly thing,
pathogen of some sort.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And
I like how you're trying not to give it away. It's like a 1972 movie, and you're like, I don't want to give anything away to anybody.
It's a great movie, though. You guys can go watch it.
All right, all of you video people, tonight, Andromeda Strain, watch it.
These violent scenes in it was rated G. This is like an early rating, so it's like a G rating.
Yeah, that's like the 1970s G rating. You're like, what? Today, yeah. All right. Well, the 1970s, they were wild in every way.
But there's a scene in which a woman who has epilepsy, you know, is affected by a flashing red light.
Oh.
So that was the reference to Andromeda Strain. So.
Yeah. I'm feeling a little post-dictal here after that. So. I think, oh, man, got to move on. Let's go.
Yeah.
I don't even know what line to go to. So we're just going to play line roulette here. Robert in Washington, D.C., watching on Catholic.com. We're glad to have you, Robert. Please go ahead with your question while I rest my eyeballs for Mark Brumley.
Yes, thank you. Wondering if anyone there is familiar, and great timing that we have the president of Ignatius Press, because he knows all about books. But
boy, does he.
Book, The Bible, the Quran, and Science. Are you familiar with the title, the book?
What you know, I'm familiar with the title, and I've seen reference to it, and even, I think, excerpts of it on the internet. But I can't speak to specific arguments that are found in the book. But I do know that basically what it's trying to do is show how the Quran is scientifically accurate, whereas the Bible supposedly is not scientifically accurate. So I know it does that. It purports to do that. But of course, neither the Bible nor the Quran is scientifically accurate in the sense that a science book is scientifically accurate. And so this is a kind of I call it, I'm not trying to be offensive, but I call it cheap shot apologetics, you know, from, in this case, it's from an Islamic perspective. It's cherry picking particular items and trying to make the argument that those cherry picked items in the negative side of the Bible are supposedly at odds with science, but on the positive side, the Quran supposedly supported by science, but neither the Bible nor the Quran sets out to do science, so it's irrelevant.
Right. So really, just skimming the surface, saying, "Here's a problem," and not taking the Bible in its full context and making arguments from there.
Right. And you find tons and tons of this stuff on the internet. And in, I almost said popular apologetics. That demeans popular apologetics, frankly. Yeah. You know, so,
Okay, Robert?
No, thank you very much. It's difficult when you're looking for things to read that follow the church's teaching. And it's great that Ignatius Press is a good resource. In fact, I think I just heard Father Pacwa recently say that he likes the Ignatius Bible and uses that when someone asked him, what should I look for?
Dude, I was listening to the same show. I heard Father Pacwa say the exact same thing. And I forgot to tell Mark about it, so I'm glad you called, Robert.
Corroboration here.
Yeah. Robert, thank you very much. And looking for good Catholic stuff, you can go to ignatius.com. There's another website I want to give out. What is it?
Let's see.
Catholic.com. Thanks, Robert. Miguel in Arizona, you're next, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Miguel, go ahead.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. I really appreciate it.
You're very welcome.
So I have a question on Canon 1251, which is abstaining from meat on Fridays.
Okay, let me see if I got my.
He's getting his canon. Miguel is getting his book of canon law.
Looks like somebody swiped it out of my office. So, oh well.
Well, that's against the law to steal someone's book of canon law.
Yeah, but I think I'm the only guy in the building that has a copy, so people come in.
You probably have one of those computer machines somewhere in your office. Type it in there. Yeah. All right, go ahead.
I think I know the canon, but go ahead.
Go ahead, Miguel.
Is canon law a big T tradition or a little T tradition? I'm assuming specifically canon 1251 is a little T tradition that can be changed by the Pope or the council of bishops, right? But it says you're supposed to abstain from meat every Friday. And when I was growing up, it was like, oh no, it's abstain from meat just on Lent Fridays and Ash Wednesday. But that's what you can abstain from it.
So let's back up just for a second, because I need to get some context here. You said when you're growing up, it was abstain from meat only on Fridays during Lent. Did I understand you correctly?
Do we lose him? Miguel?
Yes. So, yes, I'm here.
Oh, so that's what Mark's asking you, not me. When you were growing up, was it the only time you abstained from meat was on Fridays during Lent?
Was during Lent.
Okay.
Yeah, during Lent.
Ah, okay.
You're younger than Mark.
But somebody pointed out to me that you're supposed to abstain every Friday according to Canon 1251.
Got it. Okay. So let's put this in context. It is the case, according to Canon 1251, that let's read it, and this is the online version, so it's not the latest translation. Abstinence from meat or for some other food as determined by the Episcopal Conference is to be observed on all Fridays unless a solemnity should fall on a Friday. Abstinence and fasting are to be observed on Ash Wednesday and Good Friday. So this is speaking of the general law for the Latin Church. And it's true that you are to abstain from meat. But you notice that there is a qualification there that has to do with Episcopal conferences. And it is the case that you can substitute some other form of penance for abstinence from meat in the United States. That's something you may do. So Fridays are days of penance, and abstinence from meat is the general or usual form that penance takes. However, Catholics in the United States are allowed to substitute some other kind of penance. So it's probably the case growing up, you were not aware that Friday was a penitential day, I suspect. And the only thing that you took away from that, or you were told about that, was that you don't have to abstain from meat on Friday. And then when Lent rolled around, everybody underscored the fact that you're not supposed to eat meat on Fridays during Lent. So you interpreted that as meaning that Fridays weren't days of penance. There wasn't to be abstinence from meat on Friday, but this was something that only happened during Lent. But meanwhile, all along it has been the case that Fridays are days of abstinence from meat. It's just that lots of people aren't aware of that. They came away with, well, you don't have to abstain from eating meat on Friday. But they didn't come away with the idea that you had to do some other penance if you chose not to abstain from meat. And that's the situation that we're in. Nowadays, Catholics are generally, but not universally, more mindful of the fact that Fridays are penitential days, and many Catholics do abstain from meat on Fridays during the year. I generally do. If for some reason I don't, because maybe I'm going to somebody's house for a dinner party and they're serving me a nice big juicy steak or something like that, I will choose to do some other form of penance on Fridays. So does that help clarify how you came away with that impression growing up? Okay.
Right, that helps clarify it. And so that leads to the third part of the question, is not following Canon 1251 a mortal or a venial sin?
Well, what are the conditions? What do you understand the conditions being for a mortal sin?
It has to be grave matter. You have to have full knowledge, and it has to be an act of your own will. You can't be coerced to do it.
Okay. All right. So is it grave matter if the church puts in place a general norm for abstinence for penance? I'm going to say yes, partly because of the nature of penance, but also because of the authority of the church. Okay. And the second question is, do people generally know that Fridays are days of penance?
Well, no, they don't.
And do the people who – do they generally know that they're supposed to abstain from meat or find some other form of penance for Friday? I don't think they do.
Yeah, same answer, right?
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Right.
So my conclusion is that this is a serious matter, but that most people are not well informed about it. They're not deliberately ignoring the church or thumbing their nose at the discipline of the church. They just don't know that it is what it is, or they think it's something, well, that used to be the case in the olden times, but nowadays we don't have to do that anymore, and we don't really even have to do any kind of penance on Friday. It's not that big a deal. I think that's how a lot of people think about it.
I'm sure that's true. Unfortunately, I think that's also how people think about Holy Mass, is that many people no longer know that they have an obligation to assist at Mass every Sunday. So those are the times we live in.
I remember I may have told the story before, giving a class for people who are going through the Archdiocesan program for ministry formation here in the Archdiocese of San Francisco. This was many, many years ago now. And one of the guys there is obviously he's involved, serious level, trying to learn about his faith, involved in some kind of ministry formation. We were talking about the commandment that you have to go to Mass on Sunday, you know. That's how Christians or Catholics observe the Lord's Day, the commandment, keep holy the Lord's Day, Sunday Mass. And he said, really? You really have to do that? That's part of the way we fulfill that commandment? I mean, don't you just mean like maybe once a month or every other week or something?
Yeah.
I said, no, that's not it. Now, this is a good guy, well-intentioned, wasn't trying to be rebellious, just literally did not know that there was a Sunday Mass obligation. So, yeah, we got a lot of faithful mission to do.
We need some little nun somewhere to start a TV network and a radio network where we can just talk about these things so people will know.
Yeah. It's part of our discipleship. Penance is part of our following Jesus.
Right.
Observing penance and listening to the church and taking direction from the church is part of what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. Attending Mass, participating in the Eucharist, which is the source and summit of the Christian life, is part of what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. So that's why these things are serious things in their own right. It's also why we need to be taught about them and carry them out.
All right. Miguel, thank you again for the question. I'm late for the break. I got to take a break. We'll be right back with more questions. No, that was me. More questions from Mark Brumley on Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Go forth and preach the good news. It's not just a suggestion. If you want to take more seriously the command of Jesus to share the gospel with those around you, consider joining St. Paul Street Evangelization. It's a grassroots organization that brings the Catholic faith to the streets in a non-confrontational way. Visit our website, www.streetevangelization.com, to learn more. And don't forget to like us on Facebook. It's time to do our part.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I think EWTN News Nightly is beneficial in a number of ways. Not only do we provide the news of the day, but also thoughtful analysis on important issues. And it's all viewed from the lens of a Catholic perspective, something you will not find in mainstream media.
EWTN News Nightly with Tracy Sabel. Tonight, 9 Eastern on EWTN Television and Radio.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. For Lent, we decided on the last break, no music. Or it could be Zach couldn't find the music. I don't know which one. It was something like that. But I think for Lent, no music when we come back from the last break.
Music got raptured, man.
It got raptured. I'll tell you what. There are some people who listen to this program who would love it if that music would get raptured. At least once a month, we get a note going, please, for the love of all that is holy, get new music. And we just ignore that because it's very expensive to get new music. And we like the music. Jonathan in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, listening on the Catholic Answers app. Thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Jonathan, go ahead with your question for Mark.
I just want to say you're welcome. I also wanted to say I'm a former Sabia contest,
So I just want to say, your show is really great. It brought me home. Anyway, so here are my two questions.
Wait, I didn't fully understand that, but I'm so happy you said what you said. But did you say you're welcome at the beginning? Because I said thank you for your call. Is that what I... Or?
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't... Sorry, I just... Jonathan, I didn't want to miss what you were saying. But so you were a sede vacantist, meaning you didn't believe that there was anyone sitting on the seat, the papal seat, papal throne. And now you've given that up?
Yep.
All right. Well, God bless you. And Catholic Answers played a part in that.
Yes, 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 it did.
All right. I am so slow. It took me all that to put that together that everyone else got right at the beginning. Go ahead with your questions for Mark.
All right. So these two questions are a little weird, so I'm going to try my best to say it the best way I can.
Okay.
So a question that I never thought before was, you know, and this is a common objection, especially among atheists, that God created evil. And so I was looking at all the articles on Catholic Answers and everything, and it was talking about, you know, God creating himself and all these stuff. And I'm like, my first question was, number one, can God create himself, like replicate himself? And it led me to another question was, and I know it sounds weird because I'm not an Arian. It was just something interesting. What's the best way to teach a person that Jesus wasn't like a created being? Because in the Nicene Creed we say that he was begotten from the Father.
Okay, so two questions. Is God able to create himself? But you said replicate himself too, Jonathan, which seems like two questions. But you're saying could God create another God like himself?
I'm sorry, say that again.
Were you asking, Mark, if God could create another God like himself? Or were you asking, did God create
him?
Oh, okay. Mark?
So God can't create another God like himself because God can't do contradictory things. So God is eternal, uncreated. So an eternal, uncreated being can't create a being that's not eternal and uncreated. See, there's an inherent contradiction there. An uncreated being can't be created by definition. So God can't do contradictions. So that would be a contradiction. So that's the first point. Then the second point had to do with Jesus and understanding.
How could you explain to someone that Jesus is uncreated, that he's the begotten, only begotten Son?
So I need to know who I'm talking to. So if I'm talking to someone who already believes that Jesus is divine, then it's a question of trying to understand what it is somebody believes. If it's somebody who doesn't believe Jesus is divine, then I have to know what that person thinks about God. So I'm not sure which. So Jonathan, who are we trying to explain how Jesus is uncreated to?
His friends.
Say that again, please.
My atheist friend.
Oh, okay. So an atheist. Gotcha.
So you're talking to an atheist. So an atheist is saying, I don't understand the concept of how Jesus could be uncreated. So we're going to say, well, remember, we say that Jesus has two ways of acting. He is God. He's the uncreated God, second person of the Blessed Trinity, from all eternity. And he has, so we'll say, a kind of a God way of acting, that divine nature. And he has a human way of acting, call that a human nature. That human way of acting is created, didn't always exist. Jesus's God way of acting, so to speak, has always existed because God has always existed. So an analogy that sometimes you use, C.S. Lewis is famous for this, he uses the image of an author and the characters of a story or a novel or a play. And God is the author of the play. And he writes himself as one of the characters into the play. He exists outside the play, his sphere, his time, so to speak. We know God is timeless, but as an author, you think the author's time is distinct from what happens in the play. It's a different the story in the play or the novel or the story, time in that is different from the author's time. So God's author time is eternity, but he writes himself in as one of the characters in the story, and all he does, all the things as other characters in the story do. He's a human being in that story, like the other characters in the story, human being, but he also has his life outside of that. And so we can think about the second person of the Trinity, or Jesus, in the incarnation, is kind of like that. God outside of the story, second person of the Trinity, as God, but as a character in the story, he's human, he's man, and so he has his way of being and acting in the story as a character that's created. And so that's one way of thinking about it. Does that help?
Thank you so much.
Sure.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you very much. And thank you for the kind words, Jonathan. I really appreciate that.
Yeah.
I'm going to get as many as I can on. The lines stay full. We're going
Let's go for it.
Western Australia. Jim in Western Australia, watching on Catholic.com. You there with us, Jim?
Hi, Si. Hi, Mark.
Hi, Jim.
Hi.
Are you near Perth?
Mark, I really... What's that?
Are you near Perth?
No, I'm not in Perth. I'm about 450 kilometers from Perth.
I got to go look up what kilometers are, because Americans don't know what that is. But all right,
six tenths of a mile.
Oh, six tenths of a mile. All right.
We're near Walpole, between Walpole and Albany.
All right, go ahead, Jim.
Mark, I really wanted to thank you for a production that Ignatius did called "Did Jesus Really Rise from the Dead?" My boys and I watched that at Easter time. And they really enjoyed it. It really made the reality of the resurrection, brought it home to them. So
beautiful.
Thank you for that.
Bravo.
Oh, good. I'm glad that was helpful to you.
Yeah. My question was, looking at history in light of all the amazing inventions that we saw from the Greeks and the Egyptians before the time of Christ, is there an argument for non-believers, a convincing argument, why they should believe that the church, the culture that the church created, is responsible for the advances in science through the Middle Ages into the modern era?
Well, there are arguments that are made. In fact, Father Stanley Yockey was a priest who was also a physicist, is famous for writing a lot of books on the history of science, and he argues that it was the Christian matrix, the matrix of the Christian faith, that gave a great deal of impetus to the emergence of science in the Western world. Obviously, there were other factors as well, but the church's invention of the university system, the beginning of the scientific method in Roger Bacon, who was an early, he was a priest, who was an early scientist and philosopher of science, and so on, and late medieval scientific emergence of scientific techniques and ideas at the end of the Middle Ages and the early modern period really contributed to the emergence of science. And it's more complicated than that, but I think if you look up the works of Father Stanley Yockey, that's J-A-K-I, he would be a valuable source of information on the subject.
Okay, Jim?
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that call and that question. That's one that we got to do a better job at. I'm so glad that Father Yockey did that work, but it's something that we have to do. I mean, there's people who really believe that the whole entire Middle Ages was an intellectual backwater. And that's... I mean,
that's not, just false.
It's just false, right. And not even a secular historian would say things like that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a complicated conversation, but yeah.
Why do you say it's a complicated conversation? Because the church's reactions to scientific advances were varied.
There's that, but there's also the fact that scientific knowledge, the emergence of science, and more the scientific method, was something that occurred through many. There are many elements that contributed to that.
So I gotcha. Yeah,
it wasn't just the church. There were other things involved. But,
yeah. Well, you know, John Kennedy said, "Success has many fathers." And so, and I always like to close with the John Kennedy quote. Thank you, Mark Brumley. You're always doing good when you close with the John Kennedy quote. Mark Brumley is the president of Ignatius Press. You should check out all the stuff they have over at Ignatius.com. What was the name of the thing that Jim was talking about? Did Jesus rise from the dead?
Did Jesus Really Rise from the Dead? It's a video.
It's a video.
And there's also a book by Carl Olson, the same title.
Oh, the great Carl Olson. Did Jesus Really Rise from the Dead? Check that one out. Maybe you can do that with the kids around Easter time. Tomorrow, I think we're doing RCIA open forum. So you got to be in the RCIA, and then you can call in and ask anything you want. We'll see you then.